In the Galapagos Islands, both in time and space, I felt myself brought within reach of that great fact, that mystery of mysteries, the first appearance of new beings on this earth.
By October 1835, we had been in the Galapagos archipelago for some 3 weeks. And with each new island that we visited, the more certain I became that the natural history of the region was eminently curious. I was astonished at the amount of creative force on those small, barren, and rocky islands. Most of the plants and animals I had thus far examined appeared to be aboriginal creations found nowhere else on our planet. Yet although many of them bore a marked relationship to species on the South American mainland, they differed distinctly from island to island. I had no answer to the mystery, but of one thing I was convinced. In quite recent geological times, the unbroken ocean was here spread out. If each individual island in the group had been thrown up from the bed of the ocean, then every form of life must have made its way there by one means or another.
To me, it was clear enough how some of the colonists had arrived on those lava-strewn shores. The many fur seals must have come north, all the way from the Antarctic, with the cool currents sweeping up from the southern oceans. It was truly extraordinary to watch these creatures in their winter overcoats beneath the warmth of the equatorial sun. They reminded me of our own crew aboard the Beagle, whenever the midday sun became too intense and the cool water the only congenial environment.
Go on, Mr. Darwin. Go on, Darwin.
The water's good.
Let's see the scurra swim.
Jump!
But what of the many reptiles that could not swim? The tortoises and land lizards that abound throughout the Galapagos? It seemed to me impossible that so many different varieties had all made that perilous 600-mile crossing on pieces of driftwood or floating vegetation.
I watched a pair of land lizards fighting over a piece of territory. So barren a spot hardly seemed worthy of their ferocious encounter. But with these hideous creatures, The determination of the stronger to drive off the weaker was a most powerful and basic instinct. No pity was shown to the loser. He had to seek out another territory, less hotly disputed, while the winner remained in solitary command.
In my imagination, I tried to conceive of those distant epochs when reptiles similar to these, but of enormous size, dominated the world. I had the feeling that I was nearer than I had ever been to the beginnings of life. Whenever a new outcrop of land is thrown up out of the turbulent ocean, the first carriers of the seeds of life must surely be the seabirds. Largest of these that I saw were the frigate or man-o-war birds, so named for their habit of harassing and plundering other species. They had been reported as much as 1,000 miles from the nearest land, even though they lack the ability to alight on the surface of the water. And this must increase the likelihood that they carry seeds and tiny insects with them from their place of departure, lodged in their claws and plumage. In the breeding season, the male frigate birds put on a remarkable display. Directly under their throats, they have a bright red inflatable pouch. It acts as a potent lure to the females patrolling the skies above them in search of a partner. Only those males in prime breeding condition possess this outward symbol of their ability to enter into courtship. Thus the female wastes no time in her search for a suitable mate. As with the lizards and other species I observed, the same principles appear to be at work. In the relentless struggle for life, only the strongest and most vigorous survived. In total contrast to the fierce men of war, the blue-footed boobies were of such a tame and stupid disposition that we could have killed any number of them for our table. But even such large and unharassed colonies of seabirds had devised means of ensuring that the strongest will survive. In their nesting grounds, I noticed that although 2 eggs are usually laid, only 1 chick grows to adulthood. The one that first succeeds in gaining its parents' attention on each return from a fishing expedition. If it is to live, the chick, on its own initiative, must recover the half-digested fish from its parent's gullet. How can the harsh lessons of existence be learned so young, except by instinct? It was as if Mozart, instead of playing the piano at 3 years old with wonderfully little practice, had simply played it instinctively, with no practice at all.
Is that starboard gallant sheet jammed?
Check yes, it is. It's jammed.
Starboard main tops.
Right. Have a look in the foremast. Starboard gallant sheet seems to be jammed. Can you clear it?
Aye, sir.
An activity as complex as sailing the Beagle clearly requires skill and coordination on the part of her crew.
Hoist the inner jib when ready.
Aye, aye, sir.
Yet I was observing activities in the natural world requiring an equal measure of skill. Some indeed of infinitely greater complexity. Unless some other species were of equal intelligence to man, then the only way they could perform such tasks must be through inherited instinct. We had heard so many stories of the large number of tortoises and lizards killed or removed from the islands whenever a ship came this way, that I was therefore the more astonished by the extreme tameness of the birds. The doves, particularly, have been greatly persecuted by sailors, who took cruel delight in knocking down the pretty creatures as if their very tameness were an affront. I was told a man might kill 6 or 7 dozen in a morning's walk. Yet, in spite of this persecution, the birds did not readily become wild. While resting one day with Covington, a group of mocking thrushes gathered to sip from our pitchers of water. They had yet to learn that man is a much more dangerous animal than a lizard or a tortoise. On one occasion, I endeavored to see how near I could approach to a hawk. An English hawk would long since have taken fright, but he showed no sign of alarm. As I moved closer, he continued to stand his ground. It was only when I finally raised my gun that he decided to take himself off. But of all the creatures that excited my curiosity on that extraordinary group of islands, the ones that were to influence the development of my theories over many years were so dull and common in appearance that I very nearly failed to notice them at all. These were the finches that climbed and darted about amongst the cactus trees and other bushes. Although they were all clearly related to each other, there were also distinct differences, particularly in the size and shape of their beaks. The true significance of this, and the possibility that it might shed some light on their distribution throughout the islands, did not occur to me. And those that I kept for my collection became mingled together in the most haphazard fashion. Between us, we had observed 26 species of land bird on the Galapagos Islands, of which 21 can be found nowhere else. But of the 11 marine birds we counted, only 2 were unique. Why this should be so, I could not deduce, unless the land birds, with their greatly restricted mobility, had undergone changes after their arrival. But as we hoisted sail for the last time, I was many years from such conclusions.
Mr. Bosun, carry on and weigh. Set the fore topsail and t'gallant.
Aye, sir. Set the fore topsail and t'gallant.
It is the fate of every voyager when he has discovered what object in any place is most worthy of his attention to be immediately hurried from it. On October the 20th, 1835, we commenced the long passage towards Tahiti and Australia.
I wish we'd kept a better record of exactly which island some of these finches came from, Collington. Didn't seem very important at the time.
If you don't mind my saying so, sir, I think we collect too much. Just occasionally, sir.
They're all slightly different, that's the problem. Take a look at their beaks. You can actually arrange them in order. The ones with large beaks at this end, tapering down to the sharp and narrow beaks over here.
I can see that, sir.
The trouble is, I don't have a complete record of exactly which island the birds came from.
Perhaps the captain could help you. His notes are very detailed.
Does he have the names of the islands where he got his finches?
I think so, sir. Colour of the eyes, everything.
How thumping incompetent I am, Covington.
There's a story going the rounds that of the two of you, the captain proved to be the more observant naturalist. Is there any truth in that, Mr. Darwin?
Perfectly true, Mr. Wickham. We've decided to change places. From now on, I am to take command of the ship.
Then I shall be the first man overboard. I'd rather take my chances with the sharks.
It can't be denied. I've tried to be a sailor.
And it can't be denied. You failed.
You'd have been astonished, though, Wickham. We found finches with beaks like parrots, thick enough to crack a nut. And others with beaks so thin and pointed they could pierce a plant and suck moisture from it, or pick up seeds from the hard ground. But I still can't understand why there should be so many of these species here.
On the eighth day, the Lord ran out of new ideas.
Put the question the other way round, philosopher. Why not? Why shouldn't God create as many different finches as he likes? He's created a considerable variety of human beings.
But assuming their ancestors came from South America, we still have to explain their distribution amongst the islands. Your own notes show that, Fitzroy.
I don't see your difficulty, Darwin. We know that the currents between the islands are very strong.
Yes, I can vouch for that.
And the wind's generally light.
It would appear so.
With very little inducement to migrate from one island to another, the climate and vegetation being much the same, they simply stay where they are.
But we never saw so many species of finches on the mainland.
We never looked. Earthquakes seemed more important at the time, as I recall.
But why should such tiny spots of land get their own species?
I see the Galapagos as a wonderful example of the works of nature. Each creature perfectly adapted for the place God intended for it.
Our Garden of Eden.
Hmm.
I thought you said it was more like the first ring of hell, Captain.
I was not speaking of a human paradise, Mr. Wickham.
Well, my own observations were a thorough mess. I almost wish I could persuade you to turn the ship round and go back again.
That you cannot.
It never occurred to me that islands in sight of each other could have such different fauna.
Well, don't let it worry you, philosopher. I'm glad my notes proved of some small assistance. And if I might venture a suggestion, in the future, observe the mysteries of nature rather more closely and theorize about them rather less.
After 5 years circumnavigating the world, we were all utterly homesick. Every man aboard was dreaming of England. And in truth, there was no country which had any attraction for us now, except it was seen right astern.
Well, don't read it now. Go through it at your leisure and give me your opinion in a day or so.
I'm sure it's a most excellent account.
Of course, it's far from finished. But I've covered the salient features of the voyage more than adequately, I think. Some may find it overlong, but I'm convinced that a proper record should be set down.
It's unthinkable it should all just end in oblivion.
What of your own work?
I've kept a diary, as you know, but as much for my own use as anything.
Parts of it might prove of a more general interest. If you were agreeable and would consent to put it at my disposal, there might be some way of incorporating it with my own narrative.
I'm afraid it's little more than daily chit-chat.
Well, I'm thinking particularly of the land journeys when I was not present. To omit those would be to give an incomplete account of our adventure.
That's very kind of you, Fitzroy. Much of it's already in England, but if you think it will be of any use, of course.
And some of your notes, as the ship's naturalist, might take the form of an appendix. Well, we can discuss the details later. Meantime, I'd be most grateful of your opinion of my poor efforts.
Captain, one philosopher, one of your long discussions.
He wants me to give an opinion on his journal of the voyage, and perhaps loan him my diary so that he can include a few extra passages.
Well, don't tell me you agreed to such an arrangement.
Why not? I'm sure it was most generously meant.
But if he's to have the arranging of the material, he'll be using your narrative to embellish his own.
He is the captain, my dear Bino. Surely he's entitled to present the official version of the voyage.
But you two can't even look at the same rock without disagreeing about it.
You forget, Wickham. I'm here as Fitzroy's guest, and have been these last 5 years.
Well, I still think you should publish separate accounts.
I doubt if I should ever find the time. As soon as we land, there's all my specimens to be sorted out. After that, I have to decide what to do with my life. It's easy for all of you. Your paths are set. No doubt you'll all become admirals and stand no track from the likes of me.
Oh, I don't mind telling you, philosopher. You've changed my way of looking at things in the last 5 years. More than you know. And I'm no more tired of your company now than I was 2 weeks out of Plymouth.
I hate it when a voyage comes to an end. We all say we'll meet again soon, but we know we won't, even as we say it. We'll be blown to the four corners of the earth. I'll go on deck.
With Fitzroy's words in mind, I began to record in my diary a summary of our experiences. The pains and pleasures, advantages and disadvantages of a long voyage, such as we had undergone. Without doubt, it was a high satisfaction to behold various countries and the many races of mankind. But that in itself is not enough. It is necessary to look forward to a harvest, however distant it may be, when some fruit may be reaped, some good effected. Among the scenes which had most deeply impressed themselves upon my mind, none surpassed the great primeval forests, undefaced by the hand of man. Whether they were the lush tropical areas of Brazil or those of Tierra del Fuego, where death and decay prevail. Can stand in those solitudes unmoved and not feel that there is more in man than the mere breath of his body.
Why should those arid wastes have taken so firm a hold on my memory? I can scarcely analyze the reason, but it must be partly owing to the free scope given to the imagination. During my travels, I had learned that, as with music, a person who understands every note will more thoroughly comprehend the effect. When looking down from a great height, the mind, undisturbed by minute details, becomes filled with the stupendous dimensions of our world. If, as the ancients supposed, the flat earth was once surrounded by an impossible breadth of water, or by deserts heated to an intolerable degree, who would not look at these boundaries to man's knowledge with deep but ill-defined sensations?
Why not a catastrophic flood? A terrible deluge. The waters rise, pounding the stones together. Mountains collapse into the valleys, leaving sheer walls of rock. Then the waters fall away.
But the pebbles, Fitzroy. You can't produce millions of pebbles as smooth and as round as this in 40 days, or even 400 days.
If the Almighty can create a round earth and a round moon, why should a few round pebbles be beyond him? Suppose these creatures died out. But why should God destroy a creature he once thought proper to create?
There must be a reason. Perhaps the climate changed, or the vegetation which they depend on disappeared.
I'll give you a reason. They failed to survive the flood.
Possibly.
There's an answer for everything in the Bible if you know where to look for it.
Nothing on the journey created such a powerful effect on me as my first experience of an earthquake. The earth, which is considered from our childhood as the very emblem of solidity and security, moved beneath our feet like the crust on a fluid. When I saw the labored works of man overthrown in a minute, I felt the insignificance of his boasted power.
Extraordinary. Seashells. Fossilized seashells at 12,000 feet, Sullivan. How do you think they got there?
All right. Unravel the mystery, philosopher.
They've been pushed up out of the sea. The whole mountain range has been pushed up out of the sea and the seashells with it. Don't you see? They prove it.
Why do you persist in trying to undermine my beliefs? We've been over this before. The Bible tells us how the earth was created. What do you so persistently set out to challenge its authority?
I don't in any way set out to challenge its authority on religious matters, Fitzroy.
And then whose word are we to take as gospel? God's or yours?
Thank you. Mr. Darwin, sir? Mr. Darwin, sir?
What is it, Masters?
It's not Masters, sir. It's Mellish.
Sorry, Mellish.
It's a long time now since he died, sir.
Masters? Yes, more than 4 years. Used to bring me a drink, you know, like you.
I know, sir. We joined the same day.
Mellish? How old were you when we sailed?
13, sir.
13?
I'm 18 now, sir.
It's more than a quarter of your life you spent on this voyage.
That's right, sir.
Well done, sir.
Go on. Fine
voyage. Three cheers for the captain! Hip, hip, hip! Hurrah!
Hurrah! Hurrah!
Hip, hip, hip!
Hurrah!
God bless you, sir.
O most mighty God, thy mercy is over all thy works, but in special manner hath been extended towards us, whom thou hast so powerfully defended. Thou hast shown us the terrible wonders of the deep, and how the winds and seas obey thy command, that we may learn even from them hereafter to obey thy voice and do thy will. Continue, we beseech thee, this thy goodness to us, that we, whom thou hast saved, may serve thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of our life. Amen.
Amen.
Exactly a hero's welcome, I'm afraid.
The travellers return. English style.
Perhaps the real reception's planned for Greenwich. Bands and bunting and cheering crowds. I shall miss it.
There will be no real reception.
I expect it'll be a month before their lordships at the Admiralty will condescend to see me. Like most human endeavour, our efforts are probably doomed to oblivion. You weren't expecting anyone, surely?
There are no Darwins at Falmouth. But I shall be on the first stage to Shrewsbury.
So, it's goodbye then?
Yes.
We shall meet again in London. The journals. God be with you, Darwin.
And you, Captain Fitzroy.
Stupid people in my coach did not seem to think the fields one bit greener than usual. But as for me, I felt, and still feel, that the whole wide world does not contain so happy a prospect as the rich cultivated land of England.
What time did they say, Papa?
About 3:30, I believe.
They're half an hour late already.
Well, we've waited 5 years to see him. Another hour will make very little difference, my dear.
5 years and 136 days. And of all the tricks to play on his own family, he just arrives, with no warning at all. I should have fainted away with the shock.
Oh, don't do that today, my dear. Young Charles might put quite the wrong interpretation on it.
No, he's not interested in me. Poor Fanny was the one he had an eye for.
I seem to remember him casting one or two glances in your direction.
Don't tease Papa. They're here.
Charles.
Uncle Joss?
My dear friend.
Emma?
Is this that young lad of yours that ran away to sea?
All is now forgiven.
Would you have recognized him? Papa thinks the shape of his head quite altered.
He's certainly thinner.
And you haven't changed.
Don't you think she's grown prettier?
As far as I recall, there was very little room for improvement.
Well, we've planted a few more trees, but otherwise I don't think you'll notice much difference.
I used to think of the Beagle as my second home, but I was wrong.
What a wicked trick to play on your poor family, Charles, giving them no warning.
It wasn't intended. The ship was due to dock at Woolwich, but I couldn't bear the thought of another day. So I left her at Falmouth and took the first coach I could find to Shrewsbury.
Some of our servants made the arrival of Master Charles an excuse to get most excessively drunk.
What news of Captain Fitzroy? Was it his company which drove you ashore in such a hurry?
By no means. He's in the best of spirits.
But his health? I believe there was some question about his state of mind.
That was 2 years ago. He seems quite recovered. But nothing will ever change his peculiarities of temper.
Judging by your letters, I don't think I should have liked him at all.
I'm quite sure he has a brilliant life ahead of him. But I sometimes wonder whether it will prove a happy one.
And what of you, Charles? What plans are you hatching?
I wish I could be more certain. I have my specimens to sort out. I'm going to collaborate on the ship's journal with Fitzroy. And Henslow has arranged for me to meet Professor Lyle at Cambridge. But apart from that...
Apart from that, he is no nearer the choice of a career than when he went away.
Returning to Cambridge was a painful reminder of how I had wasted my time there. It also brought home to me, more clearly than anywhere else, how much I had changed during those 5 years with the Beagle.
You're very kind, Professor Lyle. But practical experience hardly makes up for my lack of qualifications.
Most men of science use their qualifications rather like a cloak, simply to hide their nakedness. Isn't that so, Henslow?
But when I was up, I just dabbled at whatever took my fancy. Beetles, frogs, a little botany. Henslow knows only too well. My subject was supposed to be theology.
Yes, and you were woefully neglectful of that.
Well, then you're a Beagle graduate rather than a Cambridge one. So much the better for it.
But even on the Beagle, if it hadn't been for your principles of geology, I wouldn't have known where to begin.
But begin you did.
I've been showing Lyle some of your notes and letters, Charles. He agrees with me. They're very impressive.
It would take me months just to sort out my specimens. The British Museum wouldn't look at them.
I think you'll find we've taken great care of them.
Entirely thanks to you, Henslow.
How soon could you prepare a paper for the Geological Society?
Well, I have been working on something on recent elevations on the coast of Chile.
How about coral reefs?
But that's your subject, Professor Lyle. I wouldn't dream.
We all learn from each other in this world, Mr. Darwin, and from what I hear, you may be very much nearer the truth. That's what matters in science.
You may have gathered, Charles, Professor Lyle has a rather low opinion of some of his colleagues.
Consumed with envy, most of them. Now, if I understand you correctly, you believe that the reef is probably thrown up by a volcano before the coral insects begin to work on it. Then, the bed of the ocean begins to subside, carrying the coral down with it to great depths.
In broad terms, yes. I never saw living coral below a depth of 10 feet.
But then how do you account for the different types of coral formation? Atolls, barrier reefs and so forth?
I'm not sure, but I think the principle remains the same. Each atoll stands like a sort of halo, marking the place where some great mountain has subsided.
You must publish. Before I steal the whole idea. And don't be deflected by the Zoological Society. They're after you too, you know.
Seems to me, Charles, your chances of becoming a quiet country parson are beginning to look rather slim.
Throughout that summer, whenever I could, I visited my uncle's family at Mayor Hall.
He complains of palpitations around the heart. And he doesn't seem to be able to work for more than a couple of hours without a long rest. And what's more, he will go to immense lengths to avoid going out into society.
Have you examined him?
Oh, of course. Nothing but apparently contradictory symptoms. It could be any one of 100 causes. Prolonged seasickness, subtropical disease. I wish I knew.
Will you give me a push, Charles?
My dearest Emma, I am trying to concentrate.
What are you writing that's so important?
I'm finishing the introduction to my part of the Beagle Journal.
I thought Captain Fitzroy was going to write it.
He is. The main part, that is. But it's been agreed that my account should be a separate volume.
How exciting! You'll be an author.
Of course, it could just be nerves. A reaction from the voyage.
In which case, he should get married. That'd soon settle him down.
You mean you want me to support the pair of them, eh?
Why doesn't he marry her? Nothing would make me happier, you know that.
I quite agree. Why doesn't he?
Thoughts on Marriage by Charles Darwin. Advantages. Children, if it pleases God. Constant companion and friend in old age. Charms of music and feminine chit-chat.
Come for a walk, Charles. It will be good for your digestion.
I will in a minute. This is a tremendously important scientific study.
Disadvantages. Terrible loss of time. If many children, forced to gain one's bread.
If you want my opinion, you were a deal more amusing before you went away.
It is quite intolerable to think of spending one's whole life like a neuter bee. Working, working, and nothing after it all. It won't do. Picture to yourself a nice, soft wife on a sofa, with good fire and books and music, perhaps. One cannot live the solitary life with groggy old age, friendless, cold, and childless staring one in the face. There is many a happy slave. Conclusion. Marry, marry, marry.
Captain Fitzroy.
Thank you for coming, Mr. Wickham.
The married man. Congratulations. It would seem there's nothing like a long voyage to weaken a man's resistance. Well, I take it you won't be looking for another command in the immediate future.
I think not. As soon as our new house is habitable, I trust you'll call on us.
I shall look forward to it.
And what news of the Beagle?
The refit is nearly complete. We sail for Australia in 2 months.
I almost envy you.
I understand you wrote to the Lords Commissioners recommending me for the command.
Your conduct, above all your loyalty, during the last 5 years, had already spoken for you. Did you read the manuscript I sent you?
Darwin's preface to his journals, yes. An excellent start. I never thought he would write so well.
You seem to have overlooked the point.
The point?
Nowhere in his introductory pages is your name mentioned, or Sullivan's, or Byner's. You'll find not a single reference to any of the men or officers who accompanied him on his shore expeditions, not a single acknowledgement or word of thanks. That is why I asked you to read it.
But you know the philosopher as well as I do. It's not his nature to be ungenerous. He simply got carried away in one of his bouts of enthusiasm. It's of no consequence.
I trust you may be right. However, I do not share your view that the matter is of only trifling importance. I begin to suspect that we may have been harboring a viper in our midst.
Not Mr. Darwin. I'd stake my life on that.
Well, we shall see.
Captain Fitzroy presents his compliments to Mr. Darwin and recommends that he refer the matter of his preface to some third person whose personal feelings are not involved.
Frosty indeed.
Captain Fitzroy therefore begs to decline giving an opinion at present and will only venture to remark, his memory being rather tenacious on the subject, that there were obliging, disinterested and kind-hearted officers on board the Beagle, dated 13th of November, 1837.
I thought you two were supposed to be on intimate terms after 5 years.
It was very wrong of me. I shall apologize, of course, and make amends.
Yeah, sure you will. But I fancy there's rather more to it than that.
What do you mean?
Well, poor Fitzroy, locked into the narrow strictures of a naval career. It scarcely suits his temperament. Obliged to complete his hydrographic reports while he sees you embraced by the scientific world. Fellow of the Geological Society, elected to the Athenaeum and the Linnaean Society. I detect a touch of envy in his voice, my dear Charles.
He does have rather a perverse way of looking at people's motives.
Well, why let it worry you? You must pursue your path, he his. He belongs to a dying breed, wouldn't you say?
I don't think I would. He has a most inquiring mind, and I would have thought a brilliant future ahead of him.
And if I remember rightly, vehemently opposed the Reform Bill. In my opinion, he belongs to that subspecies of the English aristocracy, which cannot change and so must necessarily perish.
You don't really know him. He's certainly no dinosaur. The Navy needs men like him.
The Navy is welcome to him. Now, what were you asking me?
About species.
Oh, yes.
You think they all have a natural lifespan, just like an individual?
Very possibly, yes. But what determines its length? That is the problem.
Well, perhaps a change in the climate or vegetation.
But then one would expect them all to perish, not just some of them.
Suppose the world were in a state of continuous change.
And species not immutable. You must tread very carefully there, Charles. That is one of the great heresies of our age. Are you dining at the club tonight?
Not tonight. I must get a letter off to Fitzroy. Oh,
let him nurse his damaged pride a little longer. Come along.
There was one subject occupying my mind that I was not yet ready to share with anyone. There are two kinds of generation. The vegetative, as we see in the grafting of apples and roses, and ordinary sexual generation, New individuals produced by grafting are absolutely similar. But with ordinary sexual generation, this is not so. Ancient Egyptian dogs and cats are certainly like those of today, but separate a pair and place them on an isolated island, and it is very doubtful whether they would remain constant. If the propagation of a new species is determined by the changing of old ones, then we begin to see why new animals in an area might resemble those that have long been extinct. Suppose that all animals and plants, old and new, are represented by an irregularly branched tree. As new twigs sprout, so many old ones die. With so much extinction, many ancient species would have no modern descendants. And amongst the species that do live on, there would be gaps. But if we accept the endless modification of species and their geographical grouping, what are the causes of these changes? If we let conjecture run wild, then all animals are fellow brethren in pain, disease, suffering, and death, may partake from our origin in one common ancestor. We may all be melted together. The grand question which every naturalist ought to have before him is, what are the laws of life?
If it's so important, then explain it to me again. I'm much brighter than you appear to think.
You know it isn't that. It's just that I'm probably hopelessly wrong.
I won't mind, will I?
Imagine that to be a tree.
The tree of life, as you call it.
The trunk down here at the bottom would represent the very first beginnings of life.
Do you mean all life?
Everything.
The creation?
If you like. Then gradually, the branches develop. And then they produce their own twigs.
But when was there time for all this if the whole of creation lasted only a week?
You have to imagine the changes happening over thousands of years. It's only when man intervenes that the process is speeded up.
I don't think I understand.
Think of your own rose beds, or the animals on the farm. By selective breeding, man has made bigger roses, cows which produce more milk, racehorses which run faster and faster.
But that is artificial. It doesn't happen in nature.
But suppose it does. Suppose that very, very slowly, nature has produced wolves for running and moles for digging.
And you're saying that they all come from the trunk of the same tree?
I think it's possible.
I don't understand you, Charles. Moles breed moles, and wolves breed wolves. They always will, so far as I can see. And besides, where do we fit in?
I was coming to that. What would you say if I asked you to marry me?
Darling Charles, of course I'll marry you. But I still don't really understand about your tree of life.
Neither do I.
Wilt thou have this man to thy wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinance all thy days in the holiest state of matrimony? Wilt thou obey him and serve him, love, honor, and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other, keep thee only unto him, so long as ye both shall live? Then you answer, I will.
I will.
And then I say, who giveth this woman to be married to this man? Yes, that's when you step forward, Uncle Josh.
And I shall say, you have drawn a prize indeed.
I think we should try to stick to the words laid down. So, after the exchange of rings, you have a choice of psalms. You can either have Psalm 128, blessed are all they that fear the Lord and walk in his ways, or you can have Psalm 67, God be merciful unto us and bless us, that thy ways may be known upon earth.
You choose, Charles.
I think the second, God be merciful unto us.
If I may say so, it is a blessed union, which I have prayed for on many occasions, even when you were away at sea, Charles.
If it is true that all animals and all plants throughout time and space are related to each other in group, subordinate to group, then it seemed to me to throw some light on that mystery of mysteries, the origin of species. In the autumn of 1843, Joseph Hooker came home to the Botanical Gardens at Kew in London, where his father was the director. By the strangest coincidence, he too had travelled the world as ship's naturalist on a British man of war, visiting many of the countries I had seen on HMS Beagle. Perhaps it was this common experience which drew us together, but from our first meeting, I knew that here was a man in whom I could confide my innermost thoughts. His intellect was very acute, and he was honourable to the very backbone.
Well, not quite a replica of your Brazilian rainforests, but we're quite proud of it. And each year we add more specimens.
It's magnificent, truly magnificent. You know, Joseph, I feel as though my life, my work, I mean, has been marking time, waiting for your return.
Come now, Charles, you never stop. Coral reefs, earthworms, barnacles, plant experiments.
That's precisely the trouble. I've been burying myself in all that detailed work. But it's only now, and perhaps only with you, that I feel I can explore the larger consequences.
What consequences?
I'm almost convinced. It feels like confessing a murder. That species are not immutable.
But there's nothing new in that, Charles. Man is producing new plant specimens all the time, new dogs, better racehorses.
But that's all artificial, due to man's intervention. The real question is whether it's likely that species in their natural state would have remained unchanged right the way down through the centuries. Why shouldn't they have altered too? To meet changing circumstances, develop new shapes, varied colours, new organs even.
You mean that everything about us, plants, birds, animals, is changing all the time?
Yes, but infinitely slowly.
Lamarck's theory. The giraffe gradually stretching his neck to reach the leaves on the taller trees.
But not as Lamarck says, by willing itself to do so. That strikes me as nonsense. What I think I've discovered, here's presumption for you, is the simple way in which species become adapted to various ends. Some form of natural selection takes place.
Natural selection? Isn't that a contradiction?
Not in the natural world. We all accept that every living species is engaged in a struggle for existence, a struggle for food, to escape predators, and so on. I believe that that constant struggle must be having its effect on every living species.
Plants as well as animals.
Everything.
And all continually adapting themselves to increase their chances of survival.
But not consciously. Simply because the most successful modifications are the ones which will survive and breed.
And the others become extinct.
in the course of time, inevitably.
If it were true, it would turn the study of natural science on its head.
I fear it would.
Have you published anything yet?
I have a short essay worked out, but I need much more evidence.
I think you should publish, and soon.
I can't bear the idea of persuading some poor editor to publish my wild notions, and then perhaps having to apologize to him humbly for having led him into a scrape when every sound naturalist pours scorn on my efforts.
If one follows your theory through to its earliest beginnings, how many forms of life do you think originally breathed?
Who can say? Perhaps no more than 10.
You're lucky to be living in Queen Victoria's England, my dear Charles. In 16th century Spain, you would have been burnt at the stake as a dangerous heretic.
What news of Captain Fitzroy? Some of the officers on the Erebus knew him well. They seem to dislike him thoroughly.
You know, it's an odd thing, but I've scarcely seen him. You spend 5 years of your life sharing a man's cabin, and then the voyage comes to an end. We seem to have grown apart like two branches on a tree. He's a member of Parliament, and I'm bedded down here trying not to turn into a Kentish hog.
I heard one of his fellow Tory candidates actually challenged him to a duel.
Oh, I thought it was the other way about.
A duel? Astonishing. I thought that species of Englishman was extinct.
Not in the Tory party. Fitzroy's uncle, Lord Castlereagh, fought two duels when he was Foreign Secretary. And Pitt fought one when he was actually Prime Minister.
As if Napoleon was not enough.
So, what was the outcome with Fitzroy?
Still going on, so far as I know. He and this fellow Shepherd were candidates at Durham, one of the new two-seat constituencies. Both Tories, of course. There was a row over whether a local farmer had been bribed to vote for Fitzroy.
Honour was impugned.
I understand seconds have been appointed and no doubt weapons agreed. An acrimonious correspondence is being carried on, much to the delight of the Whigs and the popular press.
Well, at least Fitzroy's a fine shot. But I never cease wondering at his character. So full of good and generous qualities, yet spoiled by such an unlucky temper.
Arrogance, I'd call it.
This whole matter is already in all of the newspapers. I'm being made to look a laughing stock.
Are you sure you're doing all you can?
I assure you.
I want this settled as expeditiously as possible.
I saw Shepherd myself.
And?
He is quite enraged.
He is enraged.
He accuses you, he accuses us both, of trying to get his second drunk in order to reach an amicable settlement.
Drunk indeed. The fellow must have the lightest of heads. And what does Shepherd want now? My resignation from Parliament? My head on a charger?
He demands a jointly published statement that your imputations against his character have ended, to use his own words, in satisfactory explanations and apologies.
Apologies? Does the fellow not realize it is he who has impugned my honor as a member of Parliament and as a gentleman?
I think you should accept his terms. This matter has gone on long enough. It is damaging your reputation.
Allow me to be the best judge of that, Major Chipchase.
If you refuse, he threatens to publish the whole of the correspondence between you.
Most certainly I refuse. Let him publish.
In that case, then, I am formally withdrawing as your second.
Shepherd. Let me pass.
Captain Fitzroy, I will not strike you, but consider yourself horsewhipped. Ah! Fitzroy, you can't strike the man.
He's down already.
For the next 5 years, I saw nothing of Fitzroy. He was appointed governor of New Zealand, and I withdrew to the quietness and peace of Down House in Kent, which suited both my work and health. My dear wife Emma occupied herself with our growing family. We went little into society, and for recreation there were occasional visits to the seaside. But even such modest excursions affected my health. Violent shivering and vomiting attacks would follow. Indeed, I do not believe I ever went 24 hours without being troubled by my stomach.
If you wish to, little one. How many humblebees have you seen today?
I don't think I've seen any.
I saw one or two.
But that's because the honeysuckle's in flower.
They're very fond of that. But now, why do you think there aren't more humblebees in our garden?
I don't know.
I'll tell you. It's because the field mice, who live down there underneath the hedges, come out at night and destroy the nests of the humblebees. And do you know why there are so many field mice?
No, but you're going to tell me, aren't you, Papa?
Because the Darwin family, that's us, keep a dog instead of a cat.
You're just teasing me.
No, I'm not. You see, dogs don't hunt field mice, but cats do. So there are lots of field mice. And go out in search of humblebees' nests. And that's why there aren't very many humblebees.
Why must it all be so cruel, Papa?
I'm afraid I don't know the answer to that.
A 6 and a 2. So I can hit you there and begin to bear off.
I resign, my dear. I can never catch you now.
You can't resign. I might get a gammon.
I concede a gammon. I really am too tired tonight.
Let me see. That makes the total score 1,432 games to you and 1,109 to me.
But you are still ahead on gammons.
Ah, long way ahead. I wonder if any other couple have ever kept the score over so many years.
I'm afraid you married the wrong man, my love.
I married the right man.
It's the same with my barnacles. Once I start keeping a record of something, I go on and on. I can't stop. There's something I want you to do for me.
Yes, dear?
This is my essay on species. I've tried to summarize all my conclusions. It's very important.
I'm sure it is, dear.
If anything should happen to me, I've set aside £400 for his publication.
Happen to you, my love? What's going to happen to you?
One can never tell.
Oh, of course I'll look after it for you, but nothing's going to happen to you. Have you seen the Morning Chronicle today?
I glanced at it this morning. I never seem to have time.
Does anyone know anything of Captain Fitzroy, the governor of New Zealand? Where has he lived all these days? We do not ask these questions without reason, for we know that when a colonial governorship is vacant, Lord Stanley takes pains to seek out the most incompetent man there is to be got. But we did not conceive it possible for him to have found a man who could venture on absurdities so outrageous as those which Captain Fitzroy has been enacting.
Not again. What was it this time?
Oh, it can't be true. It's like a comic opera. Apparently, there's a Maori chief called Heke who keeps cutting down the flagstaff outside Government House. Every time Fitzroy puts it up again, Heke sends in a raiding party to cut it down. To date, 3 Union Jacks have been lost. 2 punitive expeditions have ended in disaster. Governor Fitzroy began by earning the dislike of the settlers for taking the side of the natives, and has now become the laughingstock of the native population as well for his failure to subdue Heke.
Poor Fitzroy. Wherever he goes, the fates seem to pursue him. He simply cannot bend to circumstances.
I was now collecting as many facts as I could for my notebook, especially with respect to domesticated animals and plants, mainly through conversations with skillful gardeners and breeders.
Your very good health, Mr. Darwin.
And yours. When is your next race, Mr. Brent?
Saturday, sir. We'll be releasing the birds at Dover.
And which of these is the favorite?
Well, that's the question. You ask me, sir. It's this one. Fast as they come, and she hones in like an arrow.
This is an English dragon, is it not?
It is, sir.
I wish I was as familiar with the other racing breeds.
If you don't mind me mentioning it, sir, me and some of the lads think it's about time you raced a few birds of your own. You take such a lively interest in our little club. And if I may make so bold, we're very gratified to have you as a member.
You're very kind, Mr. Brent. But it's the breeding side which really interests me. Would you say this one was a typical English dragon?
Not quite, sir. She's a variety of this one over here. We got her from across with a rock pigeon. The dragon has the speed, but the rock pigeon has the stronger homing instinct. That way we try to breed a champion.
And the poor pigeons don't have any choice in the matter.
That's right, sir. But if you ask me, it don't worry them all that much. All the males seem to fancy all the females, if you take that meaning, so we're hardly depriving them.
Mr. Darwin, could you come at once, sir? It's young Annie. She's got a bad fever.
Yes, at once.
I'm afraid the crisis is yet to come. If only the fever hadn't taken such a hold. And you, how long is it before the baby is due?
3 weeks.
Well, you must get all the rest you can. Try not to worry. We'll be doing all we can for little Annie. Remember, we have 3 lives to think of.
I'm here, honey.
Could I have a glass of water, Papa? Thank you.
I saw some more humblebees today.
The Lord gave, the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For my eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of thy people Israel. Man that is born of woman hath but a short time to live and is full of misery.
I cannot say precisely when I lost my faith in Christianity as a divine revelation. Disbelief crept over me at a very slow rate, but at last it was complete. Indeed, I can hardly see how anyone would wish Christianity to be true. The plain language of the text seems to show that men who do not believe, which would include my father, brother, and almost all my best friends, will be everlastingly punished. And this is a damnable doctrine.
To eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Fascinating. And so simple. But why doesn't he publish?
Well, you try and persuade him, Huxley. He'll be here shortly. It's difficult enough to persuade him to come to our meetings.
I sometimes think it would be a lot simpler to hold all future meetings of the Linnaean Society at Down House. Take the mountain to Mohammed.
Just imagine, for one moment, if instead of finches with varying beaks, this were a progression of skulls.
From life's minute beginnings up at last to man.
Who wrote that?
Tennyson, In Memoriam.
The idea seems to be in the air.
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Ah, Charles, we were wondering where you were.
I most sincerely apologize. I had the greatest difficulty in obtaining a cab.
Charles, I don't believe you've met Thomas Huxley.
My friends have spoken of you many times.
And I've been waiting to meet you for many years.
I'm afraid I don't get about much these days.
Huxley is acquainted with your general theories, Charles. He's just asked the same question we all do. Why on earth don't you publish?
At least to establish your priority.
You're very considerate, Mr. Huxley. I'm afraid it would be a very thin little volume. I need much more data. It would really be dreadfully unphilosophical to publish without full detail. But I will. Perhaps not this year, but I will.
May I raise one question, Mr. Darwin?
Please.
When you do publish, within the broad structure of your theory, how do you propose to account for man?
I hope to avoid the whole subject. It is so surrounded with prejudice. Although I quite see that for the naturalist, it is the highest and most important problem of all.
The idea of a world in which the balance of nature is maintained by what I believe you call natural selection. Thus far, I am with you. But in such a world, I would hardly expect one single creature to so far outstrip all the others as man seems to have done.
There, at least, you must recognize the hand of the Creator.
You mean not natural, but supernatural selection?
You see what deep waters you've led us all into, Charles.
The last thing I want is to create a fuss. Some of my theories might cause considerable distress.
Ah. There, I believe, is the reason you have not yet published.
But still, I could not bring myself to publish. In part, it was the peace and utter lack of urgency at Down House. And I believe I also felt that another year or two spent sifting through the great mass of detailed evidence I had assembled would save me from having to face the anguish of public censure or esteem.
How are the children this morning, my dear?
Henrietta's improved a little. But as young Charles, I can't get him up this morning. He seems to have developed a rash. Did you know there were several cases of scarlet fever in the village?
We must stop the servants from going down there. It's the only way.
Is it bad news, dear?
It's from a man called Wallace. Alfred Russell Wallace. He writes from Sarawak in the Far East. It's a paper he wants me to send to Lyle on the tendency of varieties to depart indefinitely from the original type. It's quite uncanny. Even the terms he uses might stand as chapter headings from my book. It's almost as if he's been reading my mind for years.
What will you do, dear?
I must forward it. There's no other honorable course.
I never saw a more striking coincidence in my life.
If Wallace had had my manuscript in his hand, he could not have made a better abstract of it.
Lyle warned me it would happen. So did you.
How soon will your book be ready?
Oh, not for months. A year, perhaps.
Then you must publish a short extract of your conclusions.
I cannot persuade myself that I can do so honorably. Not after this. I would rather burn my book than be accused of having behaved in a paltry spirit.
Am I right in saying that there is nothing in Wallace that was not in your sketchbook copied out 15 years ago, and in much greater detail?
That's true, but...
Lyle knows this to be the case. So does Huxley.
But what could be more base than to rush into print just for the personal glory of winning the race?
I think I have it. You and Wallace must present a joint paper setting down your conclusions at the next meeting of the Linnaean Society.
My dear Joseph, two of my children appear to have scarlet fever. My wife is still sick. I simply haven't the strength to go to London. I don't think I could face them.
Then Lyle and I will act as your sponsors. Do we have your full agreement?
If you think it's for the best. But you will be sure that Wallace receives his full share of the credit.
Don't worry. Now, the book itself. Have you a title for it yet?
I'm thinking of calling it quite simply On the Origin of Species.
Well, there's no more time to be lost. You must finish it.
When on board HMS Beagle as a naturalist, I was much struck with certain facts in the distribution of the inhabitants of South America and in the geographical relations of the present to the past inhabitants of that continent. These facts seemed to me to throw some light on the origin of species, that mystery of mysteries, as it has been called. I have called the principle by which each slight variation, if useful, is preserved, by the term of natural selection, in order to mark its relation to man's power of selection. We have seen that man can adapt organic beings to his own uses through the accumulation of slight but useful variations given to him by the hand of nature. But natural selection, as we shall see, is a power incessantly ready for action and is as immeasurably superior to man's feeble efforts as the works of nature are to those of art. It is a truly wonderful fact, the wonder of which we are apt to overlook from familiarity, that all animals and all plants throughout time and space should be related to each other in group subordinate to group, in the manner which we everywhere behold.
My dear, I'm sorry. Captain Fitzroy has arrived.
Of course. Of course, I'd quite forgotten. I shall come directly.
Would you prefer a proper meal after your journey?
Oh, thank you, ma'am. Tea will be quite sufficient. I found the journey remarkably easy.
We are much nearer to London than people believe.
My dear Fitzroy, I want to hear all your news. We live such remote lives down here. No doubt you heard about my recall from New Zealand. Some time ago now. I read something about it, but I must confess I didn't follow the details.
Charles has hardly any time for the newspapers.
Thank you, madam.
You were saying about New Zealand.
I'm sure you acted from the highest principles. It was my faith that sustained me, nothing else. When news of my dismissal from the Colonial Office was announced, cheering crowds burnt my effigy in the streets of Nelson. If the town had had any other name, I think it might have been easier to bear.
Such cruelty. I don't know how you found the courage to endure it. Your poor wife.
Since then, the Bible has been my constant companion.
I expect your husband told you, ma'am, when we made our voyage together in the Beagle, some of the things we saw and experienced caused us to question aspects of Christian teaching. We were still very young then. I would not do so now.
You know, Fitzroy, your offer of taking a naturalist aboard the Beagle was the most fortunate encounter of my life.
It's true. I've heard him say so many times.
She proved a lucky ship for us both. Tea hardly seems the most appropriate liquid. Nevertheless, to the Beagle.
To the Beagle.
Judging from the past, we may safely infer that not one living species will transmit its unaltered likeness to a distant futurity. For the manner in which all organic beings are grouped shows that the greater number of species have left no descendants, but have become utterly extinct. In the distant future, I see open fields for far more important researches. Light will be thrown on the origin of man and his history. Thus, from the war of nature, from famine and death, the most exalted subject which we are capable of conceiving, namely the production of higher animals, directly follows. There is a grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms, or into one, and that whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed laws of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved.
I wish I could persuade you to add just three words at the very end. Endless forms, most beautiful and wonderful, have been and are being evolved by the Creator. It might avert the storm.
I'm sorry, Charles, I don't think I can.
Your passage on the continued intervention of creative power, if only to account for man.
That subject would need another book. As for this one, all I want is to finish the accursed thing. It has cost me so much labor that I almost hate it.
Well, I can't pretend to be wholly convinced. But its importance is beyond dispute.
I hate the prospect of all the fuss. Even Emma said to me the other day that I seem to be putting God further and further off. She suffered so much when Annie died.
Remember, you have good friends on your side. Young Huxley asked me to tell you that he is sharpening his beak and claws for the battles ahead. When is publication day?
Murray tells me November the 24th.
The Origin of Species proved to be the most important publication of my life.
They tell me, he says, we're all descended from apes.
Let us hope it is not true. But if it is, let us pray it will not become generally known.
Yes.
I was much vilified, and although I had expected lively interest and controversy in religious and scientific circles, I was quite unprepared for the extraordinary public response among people who would never normally purchase such a book in their lives. From church pulpits up and down the land, and in the pages of scientific reviews, I was greatly abused. On all sides, I was accounted an evil man who had dishonored natural science and wandered into a jungle of fanciful assumptions.
Still more letters?
You don't have to read them, my love. I won't bring them if they upset you.
No, no. I must know what the world thinks, even though I haven't the strength to face it directly. Yesterday, someone wrote I was the most dangerous man in England. If only he could see me.
I prefer it when they attack you for vanity rather than atheism.
I know you feel it worse than I do.
What does that one say?
Just an invitation to the British Association meeting at Oxford.
Why don't you go, dear? Your work will be at the centre of discussion. You're well enough. It might do you good.
I'd tremble like a jelly if I went anywhere near the place. They could hardly have found anywhere better to bury my theories once and for all. There are more clergy in Oxford than peals of bells.
As we thought, Charles is managing to dominate the meeting even in his absence.
He seems to be the only topic of conversation. Where is he, for heaven's sake?
He's taking the waters somewhere. Anyway, at his own estimation, far too ill to attend.
It's only been skirmishing up till now. When do you think the real battle will take place?
Tomorrow, without a doubt. Owen?
Sly fox. Who's that with him?
Samuel Wilberforce, Bishop of Oxford, one of this city's great orators. They say he pours his sermons over his congregation like honey.
So, that's the famous Soapy Sam.
I understand the plan is to demolish Darwin at tomorrow's debate. And our friend Owen is feeding him the ammunition.
What a slippery pair they make.
Must you really leave tonight? Charles is going to need every friend he has.
I confess I didn't realize such a plot was afoot. Perhaps one more day.
I compare the development of intellect with the formation of a chemical compound.
I might ask, are we a fortuitous concourse of atoms? And I could answer that more than chance is required to order those atoms into the organic being that contains the intellect of man. Now, ladies and gentlemen, before I come to the end of this little discourse,
I'm glad you changed your mind.
May I remind you of
one must have an instinct for the historical moment.
On the
how long has this one been droning on for?
In Europe,
about an hour.
Considered with references to the views of Mr. Darwin and others. Some of my honored English colleagues in this hall today may feel that it is too large a subject for a single discourse. Shall Imperial Rome dare to comment upon the glories of ancient Greece?
Dr. Draper, I'm afraid your time is up.
Well, if I might have a moment or two more to enlarge upon this theme, Professor Hensworth.
I'm sorry, Dr. Draper.
The next speaker needs no introduction from me. He is very well known to you all, Dr. Samuel Wilberforce, Bishop of Oxford.
No sign of Owen to prompt him from the wings.
He needs no prompting, you'll see.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, fellow human beings. I do not see Mr. Darwin in the hall today. I understand he is not in the best of health. But I do see some of his friends looking remarkably like the rest of us. We are all members of that species which my scientific friends like to define as Homo sapiens, that is, thinking man, By that I take it they mean some advance on the rest of the animal kingdom, which acts purely by instinct. For myself, I have another term which I like to apply to man. Homo poeticus, or spiritual man, capable of appreciating the beauty, or indeed the ugliness, in the world around him, capable of contemplating the existence of Almighty God. My friends, I do not have to remind you of the nature of the theory we are gathered here to discuss. It is more than a theory, it is a direct challenge to Christian faith. I have heard it referred to in the hall today as Darwinism. Is this Darwinism, then, some new form of religion that we are called upon to embrace? Are we to abandon forthwith the faith that was vouchsafed to us on that day in Bethlehem, preached from the Mount of Olives, triumphantly revealed on the day of the resurrection? And in favor of what? In favor, my friends, of a view of the world of such crude simplicity, it insults the Creator. If not, as many of us in this hall would agree, it does not actually deny him. What Mr. Darwin would have us believe is that every beast, every creeping thing, every fish and plant, flies, fungus, elephant, turnip, is descended from one primordial form into which life was first breathed. Which particular mushroom, may we ask, has Mr. Darwin in mind for this singular honor? We are not even asked to believe there was any intervention of divine or human will which gave this miraculous mushroom the idea of gracing itself with the nobility of a tiger, with the delicacy of a dragonfly, or the beauty of a lily, and ultimately, of course, of turning itself into man, in the image and likeness of God, the only one of his creations to whom he has given an immortal soul. My friends, from Mr. Darwin's theory, we can draw only two conclusions. Either man himself lacks an immortal soul, or alternatively, every living creature, every plant possesses one. Every shrimp, every potato, even the common earthworm. If this is the case, I don't think any of us would be quite so ready to consume the roast beef of old England when we return to our homes this evening. Permit me to reassure you, ladies and gentlemen, not simply from the teachings of Christ alone, but from the best scientific evidence available. There are features in the human brain peculiar to man and man alone. This is no accident. It is the work of God. I see I have made little impression on Mr. Huxley. Let me ask him just one question. Is it through his grandfather or his grandmother that he claims descent from a monkey?
The Lord hath delivered him into my hand.
I think Mr. Huxley is prepared to answer your question, Bishop.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, my Lord Bishop, you, sir, have chosen to ridicule a new scientific theory for what you call its crude simplicity. For the sake of your conscience and for no other reason, I hope you chose your words with care. If I were to make a prediction here today, it would be that the name of the originator of that crude and simple theory will be remembered through the centuries long after that of the incumbent Bishop of Oxford has been forgotten.
Shame!
This is not the first time in our history that a grand and simple discovery about the world we inhabit has found itself in conflict with the Christian hierarchy of the day. When Galileo produced his evidence that the Earth was not in fact the center of the universe, but revolved along with sundry other planets around the sun, he was forced into silence for fear of being condemned as a heretic. Meanwhile, the Earth continued to revolve around the sun, and even my Lord Bishop would find it hard to deny that today it is doing so still. You chose to ask me a question. I will answer it, but first let me ask you one in return. If after 24 hours of tutelage in divinity, I were to stand here in front of this audience and make pronouncements upon the inadmissibility of the Holy Trinity, would you expect them to listen to me with care or consider me a charlatan? Mr. Darwin has spent the greater part of his life in pondering this great subject. As for myself, I have spent the last several years in studying the very anatomical question you have chosen to pronounce upon, namely, the development of vertebrate anatomy, and especially its relation to the origin of mankind. Our knowledge is far from complete, but the structural likenesses between men and apes are manifest and undeniable. Whether apes, bishops, or mushrooms are the creation of God, I am not competent to judge. It is perfectly possible to speculate that any phenomenon whatsoever has been produced by some unknown cause. But it is foolish, my Lord Bishop, for any man to abandon reason, even when he chooses to stoop to ridicule.
Hear, hear!
I will answer your question, my Lord Bishop. An ape may seem to you to be a poor sort of creature, of low intelligence and stooping gait, that grins and chatters as we pass. But I would rather have an ape for an ancestor than a man who is prepared to prostitute his undoubted gift of eloquence and culture to the service of prejudice and falsehood.
Straight with him for expressing opinions contrary to the inspired word of God. I now realize. I wish to state that I regret the publication of Mr. Darwin's book.
Shame.
Nor is it, as Mr. Huxley has claimed, a logical arrangement of the true facts. Of the unimpeachable authority of the Holy Bible.
Get out, Fitzroy! Leave the stage, sir!
Ladies and gentlemen, please!
My dear Joseph, how unexpected. Have you come to bring me news of the meeting or to try the waters?
I've never understood how a man of your practical frame of mind can be taken in by these miracle cures.
I'm convinced it relieves my condition, but never mind my superstitions. What of the meeting? Was I burned in effigy like poor Fitzroy in New Zealand?
By no means, Charles. But he was there, denouncing you for blasphemy.
It was as bad as that.
No, Charles, the day was yours. If you'd actually been there, I think they might have carried you shoulder high around the town. Huxley was magnificent. I doubt if the good bishop was ever more discomfited in his life. The meeting finally dissolved, in some disorder, leaving you master of the field after 4 hours of battle.
Extraordinary. In 600 pages, I made one reference to man, and very few to monkeys or apes. And yet that is all that the world seems to think my book is about.
And if you'd actually heard Soapy Sam, you'd have been convinced that he'd never even read it at all.
I don't really blame him or any of the clergy. Why should they modify their beliefs because of me? It's Owen. His sheer duplicity I find hard to forgive. I don't believe I ever shall.
Forget him. He's not even worth your scorn.
You know, I remember thinking, a year ago it must have been, that if I ever lived to persuade Lyle, yourself, and Huxley, then the subject would be safe. My theory would prevail.
It stands of its own accord, I promise you.
In the years that followed, I saw nothing of Fitzroy. There had been moments on the deck of the Beagle when we had seemed to share a similar view of the world. But in truth, we had grown wider and wider apart.
Robert? Robert, are you all right?
Must have been a sudden fit of depression. You really can't blame yourself in any way.
Not directly, perhaps.
And yet, you know, I've always had the feeling that somehow I was affecting his state of mind.
Nonsense, dear. You haven't seen him for years.
No. But my very existence seemed like some kind of affront to him. It happened once before, you know.
On the Beagle?
At Valparaiso. He was in a very depressed state. He took to railing against me.
I think you should put the whole sad business out of your mind. If you ask me, it was going to happen anyway.
Those are the very words that Wickham used all that time ago. Poor Fitzroy.
Come here and listen to this. Mr. Lyle has had an audience with Her Majesty. He says she expressed a great interest in your theories and hopes to have the opportunity of meeting you.
I'm respectable at last.
Don't sound so disparaging.
I didn't mean to. Anything else?
This one seems to be from a solicitor, asking you to give evidence in court.
And what sort of evidence? As to why my books should not be burned forthwith?
Well, not yours. A man named Bradlaugh and that Mrs. Annie Besant have been circulating a book on birth control. They want you to testify in their defense. Oh, you can't, Charles.
I certainly can't. What would Her Majesty think?
Do you want to reply?
I shall say, I disagree with preventative checks to population. Overmultiplication is useful to humanity, since it causes a struggle for existence in which only the strongest survive. My dear, I'm so sorry I've upset you.
I'm quite all right. Do you want me to read any more of these?
Is there anything important?
Not if you're feeling tired. There is one from a German publisher. Very correct and proper. He invites you to write your life story in a manner which will show the development of your mind and character.
Is that all? He doesn't want much. Tell him I shall have it in the post the day after tomorrow. In German, of course.
I think you should.
My dear, I don't even know this man.
Then write it for the children.
They know my life story far too well already.
But their children don't. And their children's children.
Ah. You mean for posterity. I don't really think I'm sufficiently immodest.
But that is why you would do it so well.
My dear, it will be years before I finish The Descent of Man.
Promise me you will do it when you can. It needn't be very long.
Very well. Before they come to carry me away, I'll do it. I promise.
Good.
With such moderate abilities as I possess, it is truly surprising that I should have influenced to such an extent what men believe. Indeed, I was considered by my masters and by my father as a very ordinary boy, rather below the common standard in intellect. As for the voyage of the Beagle, it was by far the most important event in my life. It determined my whole career.